The second lecture on explaining the Quranic verses that are addressing the dua, the supplications. So those supplications, we started from Surah Al-Baqarah, and now as a second lesson, I'm going to start it from ayah number 124. That is Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, 124. And inshallah, cover three verses. So here are three to four verses. So our focus is on those verses that are teaching us about supplications, begging Allah, the Almighty, the Creator. I will begin with, first of all, telling in a general, before I go into details and explanation, I will give general idea, and in order to give that general idea, I want to give, tell it in a storytelling form. So storytelling form, it is this way, that once upon a time, there was a time when Abraham was examined or tested by his Lord. He has been through tough examination, well, it may be touching many parties, particularly most of the Quran commentators, they say it was based on five questions. So those questions, be it in oral form, or practical, or theory, he has given set down for that examination. So when he did that examination, he passed. He passed all the subjects, or the questions. And when he performed well, his Lord said to him, because you passed, now I want to appoint you as the leader of the community, the president of that nation. So when he was appointed as the leader, that leader basically is the leader of faith leader, spiritual leader. So it is moral leader, spiritual leader, and religious leader, social political leader, all of them. So he was appointed as a leader of that community. When he got that news, he became more ambitious. So he asked his Allah, the Almighty, he said, what about my children and grandchildren, my offspring? So he is a kind of that you can feel, he is thinking about kingdom. So he said, okay, you want to make me a leader? So what about my offspring? Then, because that is a form of kingdom, not a merit, but inheritance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, oh, hold on. My system doesn't work like that. My system works in a different way, which is that my merit does not reach to the wrongdoers, those who wrong themselves, the polytheists, the disbelievers, the transgressors. So those ones cannot get my favor that they become the leaders of community. So that one is not accepted. Then Prophet Ibrahim, peace be upon him, so he bounced back. And after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, then Allah asked him the real choice, the honors of that as a leader. As a leader, Number one, and then Allah asked him was to build his house, the Kaaba. So when he built that, that's it. We can translate it in the form of presidential palace, where he can disseminate his message to the rest of the mankind. When he built it, and then his son Ismail was helping him, and both of them, they concluded the building. Then he said, Ibrahim sat down again for another supplication. And he asked Allah, oh Allah, make this city, make this country or city a place of peace. A blessed place which is in peace and prosperity. And give it to feed these people from these fruits, from the gardens that they cultivate. So give them, feed them, and give them whatever they need as food, the basic needs. Then after that, he said, feed those who are believers of this city. The believers of this city. That's what he asked. What he asked Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. What you feel he remembers before that he asked Allah to give favor and priority to his offspring, whether they were believers or non-believers, or good people or non-good people. But then Allah refused that. Then he remembers that he said, okay, oh Allah, feed the people of this city, those who are believers only. Now he's afraid to fall into another sin. Allah said to him, don't worry, I will also feed the disbelievers, the politicians, those gangs, anyone there, I will give them enjoyment for a while. So I will give them a luxurious life. Then don't worry, not necessarily that they become believers. Again, Allah corrected him. So from there, when he completed his job, which was to build that the Kaaba, and he raised this foundation, and he, Ibrahim, and his son Ismail. Then after that, they started invoking, sitting down and making like a kind of ceremonial dua. Then, so that is the dua that I will tell inshallah. I'll come back to explain these verses of the Quran. That is storytelling. It's in Surah Al-Baqarah chapter 2, verse number 1 to 4, 1 to 4, 5, 6, and 7. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ فَأَتَمَّهُنَّ قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا قَالَ وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِي قَالَ لَا يَنَالُ عَهْدِي الظَّالِمِينَ. He said, and remember when the Lord of Ibrahim examined Ibrahim, tried him with certain commandments. But and Ibrahim fulfilled all those commandments. And then Allah, his Lord, said to him, verily, I'm going to make you the leader for the community. So you follow that. That is now your men. And then Ibrahim asked him, and of my offsprings, to make them leaders too? And Allah said to him, no, my covenant includes not the good politicians, and wrong doers, the Zalimin. When that test which was given to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could be in many ways, but mostly it is number one, it is he was ordered to invite people to the monotheism of Islam, the Tawheed. to spread the oneness of Allah. Number two, he was asked to call mankind to learn Islam and to join the mission, which is the mission of the Islam. So to send missionaries and spread Islam, and then their base is the monastic, the Hajj place, that is the Kaaba. And also to practice good characteristics. With the good basic characteristics. Because all human beings were created in good character. From the very beginning, every person, when he or she was born, they are clean and they are good. And Allah never created someone with bad intention. So Allah doesn't create gangs, thieves, and criminals, murderers. Allah doesn't create them. But it is them who spoil their good characteristics. They change their good spirit to negativity later on when they grow up. Because and Allah, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the hadith, "Kul mawlidin yulidu bi fidra." So every person, when he or she was born, they were born with good fitra, with good nature. So the origin is good. That is one way. So here Allah given those orders, and وَإِجْعَلْ الْبَيْتَ مَثَابَةً لِلنَّاسِ وَأَمْنًا وَاتَّخِذُوا إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَاتَّخَذَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلًّى وَعَهِدْنَا إِلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَاعِيلَ أَنْ طَهِّرَا بَيْتِيَ لِلطَّائِفِينَ وَالْعَاكِفِينَ وَالرُّكَعِ السُّجُودِ. And remember, when we made the house of the Kaaba, that's at Mecca, a place of resort for mankind and a place of safety. And then Allah, when he took Ibrahim and for the stone on which Ibrahim stood upon him while he was building the Kaaba, and that became as a place of prayer. So that place of prayer, Allah says, we commanded Ibrahim and Ismail that they should purify the house of Allah for those who are circumambulating. Those who are circumambulating or circling around it, or coming from all far corners, from all the corners, from far distances, and at the same time making circles there. And those who are staying in it, those who stay in the city or around it, and those who stay inside the Kaaba, and those who are going down, going in it, and prostrating themselves in the Kaaba. Then after that, when Qala Ibrahim, رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا وَارْزُقْ أَهْلَهُ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ مَنْ آمَنَ مِنْهُمْ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. And remember, when Ibrahim said to his Lord, "Oh my Lord, make this city of Mecca, a place of security, and provide its people with purities, such of them as believe in Allah and the last day." Then and Allah replied to him, saying to him, "Qala wa man kafara fa umatti'uhu qalila." And even those who disbelieve, Allah says, they answered to him and saying to him, "And as for him who disbelieves, I shall leave him in contentment for a while. Then I shall compel him to the torment of the hellfire, and worst indeed is that destination." So it is the worst worst place to stay in is the hellfire. But those people who disbelieve in Allah or the wrongdoers, I will give them a life. Means they will get their food, their enjoyment, their luxurious life while they are alive. But only after they die, then there will be the day of judgment where they will pay the price of the wrongdoings, the wrongs that they did. All the crimes they committed, they will be questioned in the day hereafter. So then, after that, Ibrahim continued begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَاعِيلُ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. And remember when Ibrahim and his son Ismail were raising the foundations of the house of the Kaaba, and they said, our Lord, accept our service, this service that we have done. So accept it from us. Verily, you are the all here and all lower. And they continued their supplication, saying, رَبَّنَا وَجْعَلْ مُسْلِمَيْنِ لَكَ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكَ وَأَرِنَا مَنَاسِكَنَا وَتُبْ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. They said, our Lord, and make us submissive unto you and of our offspring and nation submissive unto you. And show us our manasik, our space, and of the ceremonies of the pilgrimage, and accept our repentance. Truly, you are the one who accepts repentance, the most merciful. And they continue. They say, رَبَّنَا وَبْحَثِينَ رَسُولًا مِنْهُمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِي وَيُعَيَاتِكَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. Continuously they said, our Lord, send amongst our people, amongst the people of this city, a messenger of their own. And who shall recite unto them your verses and instruct them in the book of Allah with its laws and jurisprudence and wisdom, and purify them. Verily, you are the Almighty, the All-Wise. When they, all those, those are the supplications they have submitted. This is still continuous, but I want to stop there today. I have number 2, 1 to 9. So going back to this story is that before ayah 1 to 4, 1 to 3, and 1 to 2, Allah is telling us how to pray, how to make supplication, how to start the du'a. When you are starting the du'a, Allah begins that from ayah number 1 to 2, where Allah is saying, Ya bani Israel, اذكروا نعمتي التي أنعمت عليكم وأني فضلتكم على العالمين. O children of Israel, remember my favor which I bestowed upon you, and that I preferred you to the mankind and the devils, and all that I took you ahead of them and gave you a favor. So remember the favor I have given you. Before you start any dua, then you have to remember how many favors you have, how many good bounties Allah bestowed upon you. If you have no food at all, if you have food, just think about the food, the ingredients of the food, where it came, how it was made by Allah, how it goes into your body, how it becomes energy and flesh and bones and all that, how it makes you to talk and see and hear. And from there, you appreciate that and you praise Allah. If you even have no food and you have no clothes, at least think about your own body, how Allah has created you and just put you in your mind. Then when you remember all that, from there, you have to have fear of Allah in it. Where the ayah number 1 to 3, Allah is saying, وَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا لَا تَجْزِي نَفْسٌ عَنْ نَفْسٍ شَيْئًا وَلَا يُقْبَلُ مِنْهَا عَدْلٌ وَلَا تَنْفَعُهَا شَفَاعَةٌ وَلَا هُمْ يُنصَرُونَ. And fear the day of the judgment, when no person shall avail another, nor shall compensation be accepted from him, nor shall intercession be of use to him, nor shall they be helped. So remember that day where no one is there to help you. After that, we started the dua. And the dua, when you are starting the dua, then you follow this. If you are doing this, what can we learn from these verses now? What we can learn from these verses are so many. Of of course, even now, when I tell you something simple as, can understand more than what I said to you now. So what I'm telling you now is just like a hint of what we can learn from these verses of the Quran. Remember, in the other tafsir, every verse I explained, I was telling what did we learn from here? What can we learn from this verse? So now what can we learn from this here? First of all, we learn that nobody is above begging Allah. So nobody can say, oh, I'm taught to beg Allah. I'm not in that position. So well, whichever level you reach, even if you reach the highest of the highest, still you are beggar. You are beggar who is begging Allah. So that's number one. Number two, nobody can say, I have enough things now, so I need to beg Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but for now I'm satisfied, I have no problem. So only when I am in need of it, I will beg Allah. I know some people, those who say, I pray when I'm in need of it, but now I'm satisfied, I have no problem. That is the worst thing, it's very serious wrong. Others, they may think to say that, because I don't want to bother Allah, because there are many people who are in need of Allah's help. Now I have enough things, so I shy to make more love, to put more love on Allah. For example, I remember one long time ago when I had a friend of mine, and I was explaining Islam to him. So one day he got some fever. I said to him, you just beg Allah and Allah will heal you. He said, no, sorry, because there are many people who are suffering more than I'm suffering. So I have to be someone who is understanding the situation. Those Allah is helping those who are in the main hospitals, suffering injuries and all those. So I am now in my situation, I'm in good condition, so I'm sure no problem. That means this person is not even having a bad intention, but he is resembling Allah with people who, someone who, you say, okay, there are many people who are ahead of you, who are in need of this thing, but you stay back. It's not that situation. There is hadith al-Qudsi, in which Prophet Muhammad is saying that Allah is talking, saying that in Adam. The hadith starts like that, the sons of the children of Adam. If all of you, those who are the past generations, the present generation, and the future generation, if all of you come together, and if all the jinn come together, all the insects and jinn, the people and the demons, if they all of them come together at once, and all of them ask, each one of them ask Allah one thing. So billions and billions are there, each one is asking for something. This is asking for food, this is asking for power, this is asking for something. Then Allah is able to give all of them within a second the different things that they need. And he said, Macne-Qasim, he says in the question that it will not reduce from the bounds of Allah, from what Allah has, it will not reduce from like what the ocean. If you have a needle and you put needle, if you put needle in a big ocean, if you put needle in the ocean, what can that needle take from that water? Nothing. So even that, it can, what you are asking for Allah cannot even reduce from what Allah has at the level of that needle that you put into the ocean. That is one thing. What we are learning from these verses, now I've said only two, and there are actually I have taught, so I will go through them quickly, okay? Then those Allah said, and then it is the third, the third thing is that whatever you ask Allah, the Almighty, you will get it. So if you ask something, if you ask for something which is beneficial for you, you will get it. If you ask for bad things, and you are so adamant in that demand, then you may get it. So you will not blame anybody, it's you who requested that. And again, the dua can even change the predestination. You know that we say that predestinated things, everything is already set, right? The al-qada wa al-qadr. The predestination, there are many things that can change that. Among them, or number one of them, is the dua. So that dua can change you from something bad which was already in place for you, can change it to good. Again, we are learning from here that you should not limit your begging Allah or begging to yourself only. Always you have to be someone who is who wants what he wants for himself, wants for others also. So never be selfish for the dua. So when you are in your dua, you have to remember your other people also. And that one, it should not be limited to the people you know only, even people that you don't even know them. And they should not be limited to your family members. They should not be limited to your best friends, but all mankind. They should not be limited to the generation you live with. The last generation, this generation, and future generations to come in the future. Many generations, you make dua for them. And when you do all that, your dua, you can extend it to non-Muslims. Not only that, you make dua for the believers only, for non-believers, for all human beings. So you spread that dua. Then after that, what we can learn from that also is the you can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you higher prestige or preference over other people. It is allowed. You can ask Allah. So it's not sin to do that. You can ask Allah many things, like to increase in knowledge, to increase you in faith, to increase you in righteousness, and mercy, and knowledge, education, say wisdom, guidance, forgiveness, all of that. You can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah said, you can learn all that from the dua of Ibrahim, where he said, and Allah make us Muslimain, to make us and believers and Muslimain, and says make us Muslimain. Then that Muslimain, and also he said, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide you, to show you the right place, to show you your progress, and to alayna, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept your prayers and to give you forgiveness. To accept your repentance. But all that needs also action. It is not that you are asking for something and not ever taking action. That doesn't work. If you do that, that means you are joking, you are mockery. That means you're just saying something without any action. And that is a sign of that your words are disconnected from your mind. So you are not in harmony within yourself. You are two people, one who is asking and one who is doing the opposite things. And then how do we know that? In the coming verse of the same surah, starting from number 130, and Prophet Ibrahim, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, he says, he called his children when he was about to die. He called his children, and he said to them, before that he said, "Wa min dhurriyyatina ummatan muslimatan laka," oh Allah, make our children, the children of Ibrahim and the children of Ismail, muslimatan laka, those who submissive to you. So they are Muslims. But then again, he confronted, he called them, he said to them, "Mada ta'buduna min ba'di?" What will you be worshipping after me? Then they said, "Qalu na'budu ilahaka wa ilaha aba'ika Ibrahim wa Ismail." That's Yaqub. Yaqub, he said, he called all his children. And he said to them, "What will you be worshipping after me?" And they told him, "One Allah, your Allah, the Allah of your father, Ibrahim, Ismail, and all that." So you have to, and also you ask for something, and then you put it into action. So everything needs application. Not only you have to work it hard and keep to maintain the dua. Not only one time and say, "Oh, I asked Allah last year, He didn't ever give it to me." You continue persistently, keep asking Allah, and putting effort in all that. So when you do all that, then that is how the dua works, and you can get the acceptance. From there, inshallah, why I'm saying all that is that we have to learn the ethics of the dua. That when you are in good moral and with good intention, and also with good action, and all that are there for you, then you ask for Allah help. Allah is helping you, because Allah always, when your situation, if you are acting badly, then you may get that more and more deeper into it. But if you are doing good, you will go deeper and deeper into it. Now I just conclude that.
I have a question. Okay, because what? From the story.
Before the question, I want to add one more point that skipped. That is, when Allah, we can learn from that, that you can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with what we call tawassul, interceding with only three conditions, that you ask Allah in His name, in what of His 99 names. And why? Because Ibrahim is saying, "Oh Allah, accept our repentance, because you are the one who hears all. You are the one who hears all, and you are the one who knows all." And he says also, "Anta Tawwabur-Rahim," you are the one who has accepted the repentance and who is merciful. And also, he's saying, "As is from the poor, you are the one who is high and forgiving." So that is what that's about the tawassul. The tawassul is acceptable in three ways. That you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of good deeds you perform. Say, "Oh Allah, I want to do that good deed, so Allah gives me such and such things." Number two, you ask Allah in His name, say, "Oh Allah, you are the Zakat, give me food, give me money, because you are the one who provides the food." The third one is that you may say you are group of people, and you ask one of you to start making the path, and others are saying, "Amen." So those are only acceptable tawassul. Other tawassuls are not acceptable in Islam.
Okay, from the history I used to hear before, because now you said it was Prophet Abraham that built Kaaba, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I used to hear that there are a lot of idols kept in Kaaba. And it's like every day they worship different gods. Wait a minute. And then that when Abraham was growing up, then he like fighting his father for worshiping idol, until even he went to this Kaaba where they kept them, and you know, like scatter them. So for that, they wanted to kill him, they prepared a fire, and they put him there. So, but now you say he was the one who built.
Yeah, okay.
So,
first of all, Abraham, were the missing of the two spirits. That is, when he was destroying the idols, he was in Kaaba and Iraq.
So not in Kaaba?
That's when he left. His father was in charge of those idols, and then he destroyed them. From there, he left that, he migrated.
Yeah.
And he came to Mecca.
Because we are also here is Kaaba. That's, it's not in Kaaba.
Not in Kaaba.
Okay. And then the story of Ismail, you say Ismail was helping him.
Yeah.
So what about Isaac? So where was he?
Actually, here in this verse of the Quran, Allah didn't tell us about him. So most of the others tell him that he was.
So, but I think he was the father of the Yusuf, Jacob, or all those
things. Maybe his heart was not born.
But from the other religion, they were able to convert that. All those duties that attributed to Ismail.
I think Christianity also says that.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.